You're watching the free version of Mocha Essentials. Follow along with projects and footage with a premium download available at borisfx.com. Hello and welcome to exercise 11 in the Mocha Essentials course, where we're still looking at the basics of roto, but here we're going to be using our masks. So we have now created up our final mask shapes, and we have quite a few shapes in the end. Let's just expand this out a little bit. There we go. And as we've seen before, I could color code those if I wanted to. But now we have the important task of actually getting this stuff out. And there are a few ways of applying this mask data. So I'm going to come back out. I'm going to exit out of Mocha and come back into my host. Let's give this a little bit more space. And I can open up my mat. And this gives us all the parameters available for working with our mats. So if we take a look at the top, we have view mat. If I turn this on, it's going to show us our mat as a black and white image. Let's do a quick RAM preview, see how that looks. I think it's a very rewarding view for the work we put in, just to see how natural that movement actually is. Like that. Good. So we can view the mat and then use that as a alpha channel or track mat for something else. If I turn view mat off, I can also apply the mat. So this uses it directly within our host as a alpha channel cutout. If I look at the alpha channel now, we can see we have the transparency available to us. Okay, now currently we're looking at all the visible shapes. So all the visible layers that we were working with in Mocha are being shown here. We can also have all the shapes turned on, and this is going to show us our other layers, including the track mats and the layers we use for tracking. We don't want that. So we just want all visible. Now, instead of having to go back and forth into the Mocha interface every time you want to make a change to what is a visible layer, we can just click on this visible layers button. And this brings up a big layers control window that shows us all the layers we have available to us in groups and also as individual layers. So if I turn off all the head stuff, so we go to turn off the neck, we'll turn off the face and the hair fills. Should have another hair fill there. There we go. If I hit OK on that, we've now just got this kind of fun, invisible man kind of floating around thing. That's kind of interesting. And note how when we render these masks directly through Mocha with Apply Matte, that they also take into account the in and out points of our shapes. Okay, let's just turn all those back on. In fact, I'll just undo and that should turn all those back on for me. There we go. We'll leave feather for a second. We'll come back to that in a moment when I talk about feathering overall. But we could also do things like inverting the mask. Or if we're working in After Effects, we can create After Effects masks as well. So if I click on this button, it's going to have a little think. I can turn off my Apply Matte because After Effects has now created a load of mask shapes for me. So After Effects native masks. If I hit M, we can see all of the masks we have available to us. Now, one of the things to note when we're working with After Effects masks is that these don't respect the layer in and out points in the same way that Mocha native rendering does. So what this does instead when it reaches an out point is just not do any more keyframes. If we, let's just look at that's the lips there, okay. So if we left this shape on screen, it would just be sat there for forever. But because I'd done what we did with all the other shapes when they are finished, I put it off screen there. That means that even though this mask is still visible, the shape is still visible, it's actually off screen, so it's not affecting our image at all. In After Effects, we can come in and change up mask capacity, but depending on layer order and blend modes, this might not work out exactly as you intended it to, which is why I quite like moving the shape off screen for its final frame, just so we can avoid some of those problems. One of the advantages of using native masks is they do tend to render a bit faster. The disadvantage is, obviously, if we have to make any changes to it, in Mocha, we would have to delete the After Effects mask and just generate up a new one afterwards. Not a big deal, but something to bear in mind. I'm going to get rid of all the After Effects masks for a moment. So just select all of these. So I want to take a look at one other thing. And we'll start by just hitting Apply Matte. Now, if we zoom in, you can see all the shapes are very sharp edged. If we turn off the transparency, you can see that even clearer. Now, to add a bit of softness to this edge, we can do a few different things. One of them is in the controls again, so we can just come in and add a bit of feather. So if I add a couple of points feather, that just helps to smooth it out a little bit, which can sometimes be enough. And this feather affects all of the shapes. So we view the matte again. It's affecting all of the shapes combined. The other things that we can do with softness we can't do in the interface here. We have to do back in Mocha. Now, within Mocha, we can add softness to individual shapes, either around the whole shape or just individual points. And the way we do that is if I right click and we go into our edge properties, turn our edge properties on, we have them up here. In fact, if we are in classic mode, yeah, edge properties are usually down here somewhere, down the bottom. But let's bring those up so we can see those a bit easier at the moment. And let's take the hand right as an example. There we go, hand right. And we'll give this a different color and different outline color. In fact, orange isn't going to be very good here. Let's go back to our magenta. And let's do a color overlay on the selected mask. And we'll zoom in. Now, this edge property controls softness. And this is keyframeable. If we don't want it keyframed, I'm going to go down to the bottom right-hand corner and turn on my Überkey. Now, we haven't really discussed the Überkey in my sessions, but what this Überkey does is it makes changes globally across the entire range of our shot. And this is very useful if you want to make a shape bigger across the entire range, or in this case, we want to add softness to a shape across its entire range as well. So with the edge width, I'm going to bring this up quite high, bring this up to about 12, 12 and a half, and I can either set that, which gives me a set width of 12.3 softness across the entire range. Let's undo that, Control or Command Z, or I can hit these plus and minus buttons. If I hit the plus button, it's going to give me plus 12.3. If I hit it again, it's going to do that plus again and again and again until I'm happy. And the same with the minus. I can go minus, 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 minus. And that takes me back to zero. So the plus and minus is obviously a good way of adding or subtracting from your edge width. Now, we don't have to do things across the entire range. If I select a few control points, maybe make sure all of the control points are selected in that particular area and go plus, I can just be affecting those control points there. Another way of selecting just individual control points or a selection of control points is to change what our pointer is doing. So if I click and hold on this white arrow with the B, this changes how the picker tool works. So at the moment it's set to B. So when we move a point, I'm moving both the inner and the edge point. If we have this set to E, I'm only moving the edge. So we're getting our soft edge there. If I try to move the inner point on there, I can't do it. If I go to inner, obviously that means I can't move the edge anymore, but I can move my inner point. And if I come down to the A tool, this is pick any. So that means I can move any point that I'm working on. There we go. So that's how that tool works. And let's see, because I've used the Überkey, that's obviously going to be affecting the entire shape across the range. Let's undo that because I don't want to make those particular changes. There we go. Now, these tools are very useful for dealing with localized softness in an area that you might want to deal with. Let's turn that back to pick both. We do have one other way of adding in some sort of blur and some sort of softness, and that is using motion blur. I'm going to come back to my hand again. I can see I need to undo one more time, or a couple more times. There we go. That's back to both. Yeah. And when we turn on motion blur, we don't see any difference within the preview window here. Not to worry, it has been turned on, and we can see it if we render our individual mats. So see it in the mat view here, but we're not going to be looking at mat view. Where we will be able to see it is when we take this back out into After Effects, but I'm just going to come in and turn on motion blur on all of the layers. Now, currently this is a layer by layer process. We can't sort of multiple select layers and turn motion blur on. And to turn motion blur on a layer, you actually have to be on a layer where it's active. If I come over here for my forearm track, you can see this is grayed out. But if I come over to a frame where it actually is active, I can turn motion blur on there. Okay. So once this is done now, let's save this. Come out back into our host, and immediately you can see, because we've got apply mat turned on, you can see we've got motion blur being turned on our layer as well. It's probably even more visible when we look at view mat. You can now see the motion blur softness across our shapes. Now, using the motion blur here does increase render times a bit, obviously. But once that's rendered out, let's just zoom this back to fit. You see what a difference that actually makes, especially in the fast moving areas of the shot. Now, if you want to use motion blur, but you're using the host native masks, so in this case, we create our AE masks here, these will have motion blur if we turn the motion blur switch on. If we come up to layer, mask, motion blur, we can make sure this is always on, always off, all the same as the layer. The default value of same as layer is fine, I find, because it means we can determine whether we turn the motion blur on and off. Let's turn those outlines on and off so we can actually see that working. There we go. And once we turn motion blur on, even the native AE mask rendering is a little bit slower as well. That's just the nature of the beast with motion blur. But it does give a nicer, more realistic result. And if you're using Mocha Pro, there is one other way of taking out masks that we haven't looked at. So let's go back into here. And I have at least one of my shapes selected. I can come down to my export and I can export out that shape data. And that's going to give me a list of different hosts that I can take this out to. You know, Fusion, Flame, Nuke, Shake, Silhouette. We've got lots of different formats that we can take those out to, and we can take them out either as selected layers, all visible layers, or all layers. And then depending on your host, you can either copy these to the clipboard and then paste them directly into the host, or save it out as a file to import into your host at a later date. And full details about host-specific ways of importing shape data is found in the manual. All right, so let's come back into the host. Let's turn on a little background layer. A background layer is just the original layer, just colored in red. And we can see the fruits of our labor of the last couple of exercises. So this has been quite a thorough introduction to rotoscoping. Obviously, there are lots of little tricks and techniques we haven't covered, but if you've been following me up till this point, you'll be in a very good place to start doing roto work using Mocha. And obviously, you know, a lot of the projects that you're going to be working on aren't going to be anywhere close to as complex as this one. You should have enough tools in your arsenal now to start to tackle your own project. And one final trick before I say goodbye for the roto section is to just keep patient. It's very easy when you're presented with a shot to just want to run in and start just creating shapes up and, you know, adding animation, adding keyframes to get it looking good. But if you just run straight into a shot, you can find yourself having to do a lot more work than if you just take a step back, reflect a little bit, and try to analyze the shot and how you're going to break this down. We obviously saved a lot of time by not getting into details on edges that were obviously going to be taken up for the most part by other shapes. And probably the biggest time saver is making sure that you create up your main tracking layers as well. So layers that you're going to connect multiple shapes to. Making sure that those are as good as they can possibly be is going to save you a huge amount of time in the long run. Thanks for joining me on this little roto excursion. So join us in exercise 12, where Mary and I start introducing Power Mesh. You've been watching the free version of Mocha Essentials. To download all videos, projects, and footage, purchase the premium version available at borisfx.com.